So we've looked a little bit at hemiacetals and acetals now, and acyclic hemiacetals are not very stable because the equilibrium favors them going to an acetal. But if you can form a cyclic hemiacetal, those are more stable. And so typically with 5 to 6 membered rings, which are the most stable ring sizes, they can occur readily. So an example could be this 5-hydroxypentanal. So if you look at the straight chain versus the cyclic ones, straight chain is only about 6% in the equilibrium, where the cyclic hemiacetals would be 94%. So how does this occur? So if we're going to understand the mechanism, the first thing we need to do is we need to redraw our molecule in a semi-chair formation. Remember, with our 6-membered rings, when we had cyclohexane, and the same would be true here, that they're typically going to be in chair conformations. So if I get this, so it's almost in a chair conformation, it's ready to show how it can react to close the ring. So the first thing that's going to happen is we're going to have to protonate our aldehyde to make it more reactive to our neutral nucleophile. Once it's activated, now this alcohol can come in and attack the carbonyl to push this electron pair out onto oxygen to neutralize the positive charge. Now there's a new stereocenter that's made in this molecule, and so I have a choice of whether our new OH will be going down and being axial, or whether it will be going up and be equatorial. In either case, we're not quite done. We can use water or some base to come in and deprotonate our ether. And the same can happen with the other product as well. Now, this carbon here of the aldehyde, I'll circle it all the way through, gets a special name because it's going to form a new stereocenter in a series of different reactions with sugars. And so this carbon is called the anomeric carbon. And it's going to be the new stereocenter that's going to form in cyclic sugars. So let's take an example. Let's look at glucose and see the different forms of glucose. Okay, so here we have D-glucose, and I'm not going to draw the whole mechanism this time with an acid catalyst. This alcohol will come in, will attack the carbonyl, creating the new anomeric center, or the new stereocenter. So there's two choices for how they'll be. So let's look at the structures that form. So again, the only difference in the two structures is here at the anomeric carbon. And in this case, the anomeric hydroxide is on the same side, or as syn to the CH2OH. And if it's syn to CH2OH, we call that beta. In this case, the OH in the anomeric position is anti to the CH2OH, so we call that alpha. Also, there's a name for this ring. When you have a 6-membered ring with oxygen in it, it's called pyran, or pyran. So this sugar that we have, made from D-glucose, is actually a beta D-glucose. However, it's also in the pyran form, so it's beta D-glucopyranose. That's how I would name the entire structure, beta D-glucopyranose. So now, if we want to look at the second structure, this is going to be alpha now, It's also made from D-glucose. And it's also in the paran form. So it's alpha-D-glucopyranose. So while those names sound kind of long and complicated, each piece of it tells you something about your structure. So alpha and beta just tell you about this enomeric position. D-gluco tells you which sugar you started with. And pyranose tells you what type of ring you have. So we have a six-membered ring with an oxygen in it. Now, when this forms, it doesn't actually form in equal amounts. It forms 63% beta and 37% alpha-D-glucopyranose. And why should we care? What's important about this? Cellulose is made of beta-D-glucopyranose. It's really a polymer chain of a bunch of beta-D-glucopyranose rings together. While things like starch and glycogen are formed from alpha-D-glucopyranose. So why is that important? It's important because humans and other mammals do not produce beta-glucosidase enzymes, which means we lack the enzymes to break down cellulose or things based off of beta-D-glucopyranose linkages. So since we can't break them down, we can't use those for energy, and they end up going right through our system, and that's what we call fiber, or dietary fiber. Because we can't use that, it just kind of helps go through our system and keeps us regular. However, starch, glycogen, amylose, amylopectin, all are based on alpha-D-glucopyranose, and we can break those down, and so we can use those for energy.